give you a quick overview of what we're going to talk about. Some of you may not be entirely familiar with what graphics processing units are, what they physically are, and furthermore, how to program them, well, architecture of these GPUs, and how they are the same but different to central processing units. So I'll give you a pretty basic introduction. If you've programmed GPUs before in any sort of meaningful sense, you could probably put your mind in neutral for a good 20 to 30 minutes before we get to the good stuff, where we start talking about actually programming GPUs using the CUDA programming model, which apparently is akin to shooting yourself in the foot. But that's okay. I'm not only going to teach you, I'm going to show you how to shoot yourself in one foot with CUDA, I'll shoot, tell you how to shoot yourself in the other foot programming with OpenCL. So you'll actually have a double barrel approach to making your life difficult. So that'll be the first part, and hopefully by the end, we'll have some time for you actually to do some programming so you can actively engage in shooting yourselves in the feet. All right. The second part of this, which is somewhat grayed out, I'll seriously address the issue of portability and, to some extent, performance portability. As rightly noted, CUDA is a proprietary standard, proprietary programming model, and it is questionable as to whether you should invest too much in a single vendor solution for programming. So I'll talk about alternatives. In particular, by the end of the lecture, I'll talk about how my group, my research team, actually programs GPUs and CPUs and accelerators. And we try and avoid being locked into a single vendor solution. So I'll give you an overview of how we approach this issue. It's a very serious issue. But let's have a quick reality check. It certainly takes more than 3 hours to become a proficient GPU programmer. You probably had some experience with the OpenACC tutorial, and you felt like you got something done, but you probably didn't get too deep into the actual mechanics of the GPU, the architecture of the GPU, how to exploit the architecture of the GPU. But we can discuss some basics. Fortunately, you're not the first people to have to program these things. My team started in 2007, 2008, when CUDA first came out. And it was a bit more of a Wild West situation where there really wasn't that much resources. We were scouring forums to try and find information about these things. Now, there's a lot of information out there, a lot of material. There's a lot of good online tutorials. But hopefully by the end of today or by the end of the morning, you'll have some experience, a bit more experience on top of OpenACC. You'll have a bit of a CUDA experience so that you'll actually feel, so hopefully you'll realize it's not that tricky to program GPUs. It's really not that hard. It's actually quite straightforward. But there's a sort of mysticism that's been wrapped around it to make it seem like it's difficult. But in reality, it's just a bunch of parallel fours. Once you realize that, then programming GPUs is no longer a mystery. It can still be frustrating, and in terms of getting optimal performance, there's more you need to know, but we'll get you to that point where you can realize that the basic mechanics of GPU programming is not that hard. Performance is a slightly different issue, and to get into the details of that would take longer than 3 hours. I do hope to add some more background and insight to the talk that I reviewed of Nikolai from NVIDIA so that you can see more of the inside details of what makes a GPU different from a CPU and so on. The slides are posted on the website, the workshop website. You should be able to download them. You'll notice they're password protected. Password is up there on that sheet, right there. Okay, it's a highly secure password. I just didn't want to have to go through and scrub out every single image that I don't have copyright for. So you should be able to access the slides, and they may be easier to read than the board here. Okay, is everybody able to download? Raise your hand if you are able to download the slides and view them. Okay, we're good. My goal is that, well, here we go. So not only did I set up the slides, but I've also got a repository on GitHub. You can use Git clone to access, and to, or you can just go to the website, and you can review the material in this Git repository. And we'll, at the end, we'll be using my own research team's programming environment, which you can also get through Git. Okay, so those are the three resources that you should hopefully find useful. Okay, so just to give you some background, who I am, what my research team does, who my research team is. This is a bunch of senior researchers who are industry researchers. Jean-Francois is a mesh guy. I'm at core, I'm a finite element guy, so I need a mesh guy. Have postdocs, visitors, and graduate students, and undergraduates. So it's a vertically integrated group. I put their pictures up because I have to manage this team, and it's quite a large team. And we have to have a coherent approach to software development because we're testing finite element methods, which are bespoke, which are not in any package. So we have to, and I noticed based on talking to you all and looking at your profiles up there, a lot of you are in the same business, writing your own software. Now imagine there's 10 of you in a group, and you want to write software that's not just going to be good for testing, but also can go into production within and be around for 10 to 20 years. So the question is, what programming model do you adopt? How do you program your code? Do you write it in CUDA? Do you write it in OpenCL? Do you write it in pthreads, threads? If you go back, if you want to talk about distributed computing, do you write it in MPI or before that, PVM or BSP? So we have this issue in any of group activity that you want, when you're developing code and you want that code to survive, you have to make some hard decisions. So I'm working a group of people, and some of them wanted to use CUDA, some OpenCL, some OpenMP 4, 4.5. None of them were interested in OpenACC. So the question is, how do I manage all these people? So I was a bit of an ass, and I said, okay, we have a master programmer, this guy David Medina, who is just phenomenal programmer. He's like one of these 10x people who can write code like you wouldn't believe, very fast, very high quality. And I said, David, we're gonna be a dictatorial group, and we're gonna say, you're not allowed to program in OpenCL, you're not allowed to program in CUDA, you're not allowed to program in OpenMP. We're gonna create an abstract layer, an abstraction layer, which means that everybody will be programming to an interface, and then the interface will talk with all those different threading models. So I won't have half my or a quarter of my code being OpenCL, a quarter of it being CUDA, a quarter of it being serial, a quarter of it being OpenMP. I'm just gonna get you all to program the same thing, and then we'll run it on whatever program model you like. So that has been actually pretty successful. And it means we don't care which of these programming models survive. And that's important to us because we're not computer scientists. We're computational scientists, we're numerical PDE modelers, we're physics modelers, we're domain scientists. We don't want to be dicking around with programming models, okay? So here's what my group actually does. This is the day job, right? We work at a level of approximation theory, finite element analysis, numerical analysis, interpolation theory, operator theory, spectral theory. We work with, we've developed books. I published a book on, or co-authored a book on discontinuous Galerkin methods. Some of you, I actually noticed one of the bios up there said, working on nodal discontinuous Galerkin methods, which is great, because I wrote the book on it. So I've got someone to talk to here, right? But then we go on to not just developing numerical methods, analyzing them, but also working, building codes that use those methods. And because we're not just planning for numerical methods that are good for today's computational platforms, but we want to target tomorrow's computational platforms, we use graphics processing units as the test bed. You can see the trends. You can see that we're going from one core on the Intel CPUs to two cores, to four cores, to eight cores, and the SIMD width on each of those cores is getting wider and wider. We saw that yesterday. I think you've probably heard that several times when you've gone from SSE, SS2, SSE2, SSE3, AVX, AVX2, AVX, and so on. AVX256, AVX512. Well, if you look at where the GPU is, the GPU is already at AVX wide. Okay, it's already 32 wide SIMD floating point units or vector units. Okay, so we adopted those early on, GPUs early on, because we saw suddenly that gave us a way to test the new numerical methods we're developing on tomorrow's platforms. And now tomorrow is here. We're now starting to see CPUs with the same kind of architecture. And we pay attention to scaling. So codes we've developed with folks at the Naval Postgraduate School have been run on the Titan machine at Oak Ridge, running up to 16,000 some GPUs. Okay, so we're a soup to nuts group where we work really in the weeds of the mathematical analysis all the way to delivering on the larger scale systems. To do this, as I said, we had to build abstraction layers that let us go from the numerical realization to the scalable solution on the latest hardware without having to recode from CUDA to OpenCL to OpenMP and so on. We want to make that a single stage development process. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. I think this is a great opportunity for you all to get some experience, understand how what NVIDIA GPUs are, what their architecture is, and how to do some basic programming of those GPUs. Now, at any point, if you have any questions, please raise your hand. So here's an example. This is a discrete graphics processing unit. It's a bit of a vintage model at this point. It's a model that actually has two graphics processing units on it. It communicates, so it's an add-on accessory to your PC. You slot it into a PCI Express slot, which is a slot on the motherboard. In your laptops, you don't really have those. You sort of, there's a sort of variant for a portable PCI bus, but in a regular old desktop, I think in 10 years, talking about desktops is going to be, it's going to be like talking about history. But this is a separate, quasi-autonomous compute device. It communicates with the host, through the PCI Express board. If you're going to use the graphics processing unit for its original purpose, it would communicate with the monitor through these interfaces here. All data that you want to communicate to the graphics processing unit goes through that interface. So if you want to do any array arithmetic, you'd have to copy the contents of the array onto the board. On the board, it has its own memory chips. Let's see. It has its own processors, and it requires its own power supply. So it needs to be powered directly from the power supply. Okay, so it's literally a self-contained computer with an interface to the machine that it's connected to. And here's an example where I have the worst machines. I left most of them at Rice when I left, but they had these real ghetto boxes which are sort of, I didn't even bother closing the cases because we pulled GPUs in and out all the time as they kept updating the GPUs. So we have these things stuck together with duct tape and spit. But here we've got the motherboard, a couple of CPUs hiding under these monstrous fans, and a couple of these GPUs stuck in. You can see they're powered, and the power supply is, I think, over here somewhere. This thing generates a lot of noise. But it was a great test bed for the early days when GPUs were changing very rapidly. Okay, so that's the physical realization of the GPU. Let's talk about the architecture. So you're all familiar with CPUs, and unwittingly GPUs. You've been using GPUs just without realizing it. They tend to be behind the scenes. They're responsible for pushing pixels to your displays. Okay. In fact, if I was to ask you, who has an AMD GPU in the laptop? Who has an NVIDIA GPU in the laptop? Who has an Intel GPU on your laptop? Who doesn't know? The honest guy in the back there. So we already see that there's a sort of a wide range of different GPUs sitting in your laptops. You're an atypical sample. Most people said, what? I have no idea. So the purpose of the CPU should be pretty evident to you. They're glorified word typewriters. They're the central processing unit that has evolved from being the CPU behind the word processor, where in my day when I was growing up, we had home computers that had very, very limited 8-bit central processing units. The evolution of the CPU has been guided by some design principles, which is make a single thread very fast. Think about it, you're running a program, you don't want the program to stall, keep stalling. You want it to be a fluid user experience. And to do that, they introduce large caches and operator prediction speculation. So a lot of architecture on the CPU is dedicated to trying to make the flow of instructions for the single thread as uninterrupted as possible. Now, I've got a simple diagram for an x86, one of the earlier Intel architectures. I don't want you to absorb this. I just want to point out that you have some administrative parts of the core diagram, but the important thing from my perspective as a numerical PDE guy is the only part of this architecture I care about is the arithmetic logic unit, responsible for doing addition, multiplication. Everything else is management. Management of the instruction stream to the arithmetic logic unit. Everything else is completely irrelevant to me. Right? I'll try and explain what I mean by that. So just to clarify, the arithmetic logic unit, couple of arguments, specify the operation, get the result. Okay? When we break down, say, that code that generated that fluid flow, at the core level, it spends 99% of the time doing multiply adds, AX plus B. That's all it's doing over and over and over again. That's where my efficiency comes. I want to make that operation as fast as possible and do as many of those operations per second as I can. Everything else is a pure distraction. So if we look at an abstract representation of the core, we have an instruction fetch to code unit, an arithmetic logic unit, that's the worker, some scratch space register or cache that's used to support that, and then we have some management, which just makes sure that the thread runs without interruption, so that data is prefetched. If there's branching in your code, it can do some probabilistic analysis of what's going to happen next, so it can actually schedule data and registers to be filled as best it can, and has some memory prefetch. So basically, prefetch data that's going to be needed in the near future. And to support this, a large data cache. Okay? That's basically the structure of a modern CPU. And I put up an example, which is an Intel Skylake microarchitecture. You'll have to look at the PDF to see it really in detail. But you can think of this as, here's the management marshaling the instructions for the execution units, okay? And there's some interface to memory, so you can get data. So this is instructions, this is data. This is actually the operators or the execution unit that performs the one thing I actually care about on the CPU. At the level of the execution unit, you'll see that you have arithmetic logic units. You also have vector arithmetic logic unit, arithmetic logic units. We'll just call them ALUs. That's a lot easier to say. And vector operators like shift, add, multiply. And then they have fuse, multiply, adds, and branch units. Okay. So from the whole core diagram, the only thing we really care about in terms of doing high density multiply adds for numerical discretization is this part of the architecture. Everything else is just set up to keep feeding instructions and data into the execution units as efficiently as possible. Now, one or two interesting things about the Intel architecture is that they have replicated some of the ALUs, some of the operators or execution units within the core, so that you can achieve some level of instruction level parallelism. And you don't notice it, but when your code is compiled to microcode, we don't just execute one operation at every cycle. There's multiple operations that can be scheduled together. But let's back up a little. That was a modern core. Let's back up a little bit to a slightly older, like a 6, 7, 8-year-old core. And we can see the repercussions. So what happens, because we have all this management that's required to keep feeding the ALU. And if we look at the ratio, and this is a die shot, it's basically a photograph of a silicon chip, and somebody has painstakingly gone through and annotated this so we can see what each part of the chip is doing. So we can see the functional units, the cache units, and so on. And you can actually look down here, and this is the part we care about in terms of doing numerical computations. That bottom left-hand corner is the graduate student. The rest of the crap up here is the university. Who does the work at the university? The graduate students. How is the university set up? Well, the rest of the university is designed to keep the graduate student's nose to the grindstone, right? And that's the case here. So we have the floating point unit and the integer instruction units down here. That's doing the part of the problem we care about. Everything out here is dedicated to just keeping that unit busy, okay? You all know the pain, right? You're all graduate students. You're a minority in the university, but you're doing most of the research work, right? Yeah, there's some uncomfortable chuckles there as it dawned on you what I'm saying. So, infrastructure, the compute. So, in some sense, the progression of designs of central processing units, which there was amazing progress in the 90s, which happens behind the scenes, so as a programmer, you didn't need to worry about a lot of things, because between all this infrastructure on the CPU and the progress in compiler design meant that your program could execute with relatively few stalls. And as they increased the clock frequency on single core devices, your code would just get faster. But there's obviously limits to that. And you've probably seen over and over again people talk about Moore's Law. Now, if you think about that, the design of the CPU is informed by the purpose, which is to have a limited number of threads executed with minimal amount of stall. Because they're primary tasks, running programs that you're interacting with. You don't want these things to stall. The GPU is doing something entirely different, okay? The GPU is responsible for deciding the color intensities, red, green, blue, say, intensities of the pixels that make up the picture in front of you, okay? If you look really close at your screen and you don't have an Apple Retina display, if you cheaped out and you've got a cheap Dell or something, look closely at your display, you'll see the pixels, okay? You really have to mash your face up against the Retina display to see it, but they are there. The GPU is responsible for deciding, in this instance, let's say it's 1,000 pixels by 1,000 pixels, a million pixel color values. So 24 bits have to be decided. And if you're playing one of the more advanced games, you want to do that 60 times a second. If you're going to go to 4K resolution, that's what, 8 million pixels, 60 to 90 times a second. If you're going to be using a virtual reality headset, where the guidance is that your frequency update for the display so you don't blow your lunch is 90 frames a second. 90 frames, 8 million pixels. Well, there's two eyes, but you probably only have 4 million pixels each eye. That's an inordinate number of pixels that have to be colored every second. Okay? Now, the good news, and this is what NVIDIA and previously ATI, which became or was bought by AMD, what they realized is that the threads that are deciding, and we'll figure out what thread means later on, but the threads that are dedicated to deciding what the color intensities for each pixel are, it doesn't matter if they stall out, as long as collectively you can achieve that 8 million pixel render in 1/90th or 1/60th of a second. So it doesn't matter that some threads take a long time, one 1/90th of a second is sort of the upper limit, right? Because you can't, if you want to deliver a frame every 1/90th of a second, then you've got that much time for each thread to complete its task. So the design requirements of the GPU are very different to the design requirements of the CPU. CPU, small number of threads. GPU, why not provision an enormous number of threads? Let's say 8 million threads. And then give them a small number of pixels to decide on the color intensities for. And then as long as each of the threads completes its task in 1/90th of a second, fine, you're good, right? You can deliver that frame, go on to the next frame. Okay, so that was, and just to illustrate that if you really zoom in, you'll see the pixels. Each pixel is rendered by one thread or some pixels. But if you look at, and this is a game, computer game, actually it's a console game my son plays, Fallout 4, you can see what the GPU has to do. There's a triangulation behind the scenes, well, of the scene. Every game object is a polygon. Onto the polygon, you need to basically do an interpolation for every pixel that intersects your line of sight through into the scene, will hit a number of polygons, and you want to get the, you want to figure out, based on an image that's a, or bitmap that's attached to each of those polygons, you've got to figure out what the intensity for that pixel is in the red, green, blue channels. So just to illustrate what's going on, this is, again, the same game, but without the texture map. It's just plotting the polygons, okay? And what the GPU does is it, for all the pixels that intersect, say, this polygon here that you can see, it's figuring out, based on the bitmap that's associated with that polygon, what is the intensity of the pixel on the foremost polygon that is in the scene representation from this viewpoint. So, if you think about it, it's a lot of projective geometry, a lot of multiplies, a lot of adds, but still, it's pretty straightforward. The tricky part is the scene is constructed of possibly millions of polygons. And each of those polygons has an associated texture, and there's a lot of arithmetic that needs to be done in order to figure out, well, what is the, for this polygon here that's visible, what is the value of the texture at the pixel where we're trying to query, okay? So, it's very distracting. If you'd play, who's played Fallout? Some of you might have. No? Okay. I need to, what games do you play? Any? Volunteer? Anybody play any games?
Skyrim.
Skyrim, okay. Yes, I think my son wanted me to order that for him. Anything else? Call of Duty, okay. So, substitute for Fallout 4, Call of Duty, same thing, same basic engine, polygons, each polygon has a texture associated with a bitmap, and there's a whole bunch of interpolation that goes on to figure out, for the foremost polygon, what is the intensity for the pixel that is the viewpoint through that polygon. Let's just reiterate, what are the goals for the GPU? This will help you understand the program, the architecture, and then the program model, and you'll understand the layer of what's driving the architecture, what's driving the programming model. Throughput matters, and single threads do not. The order in which you decide on the color intensities in each pixel does not matter. It is not important. You do not need to start at the top left of the image and work your way down to the bottom right. You can populate the image buffer in any order you like, as long as the whole population is done by in 1/90th of a second, or 1/60th of a second, okay? So it doesn't matter if some threads stall while others finish early. It's just the collective goal that matters. So it's not quite the right analogy, but you can think of this as communism, where the individual does not, has, no individual is more important than any other individual, and it's just the collective image that matters. You can contrast that with the CPU model, which is sort of the Donald Trump's capitalist model, where you've got primary threads that must be able to do what they want to do. Okay, it's probably not the right political model, but it's close enough. Okay. Now, the CPU and the GPU both have an incipient problem, which is they're both connected to DRAM, and DRAM latencies are very high. The rate at which DRAM serves data to the CPU or the GPU is increasing more slowly than the ability of the CPU and GPU to consume them. The number of flops you can generate is going up much faster than the amount of data you can serve. So the GPU approach to this is to hide the memory latency through massive parallelism. You're a thread, you're responsible for updating a pixel, you haven't received polygon data, so you're idle. But there's going to be thousands of other threads that can swap in. So they hide latency through massive oversubscription. So if you have X processes, then you'd have some large multiple of X threads that are concurrently able to run, or in the pool of threads that could be run. One of the genius moves that NVIDIA made was to buck the trend of the 1990s, where on-chip cache automatically managed data movement for you. So data would stream to the ALUs magically behind the scenes. Well, that's problematic because that doesn't give the programmer much option in the way that that streaming is managed. The guys at NVIDIA said, okay, let's make this an intellectual challenge and let's expose the cache hierarchy to the programmer. The programmer can decide what and when to prefetch data. So they actually made it harder to program the original GPUs than the CPUs, which is genius because it made it challenging to get best performance, but when you got best performance, it was a hell of a lot better than the best performance you could get for some applications on the CPU. So it became a bit of a pissing contest. Who could get the best performance? Who could get the best multiply ratio between the CPU performance and GPU performance? Usually that just exposed that the CPU performance of a code was bad. Anyway. And then the other thing they did was they avoided high-frequency clock speeds. So instead of just ramping up the clock speed in some sort of a marketing promotional approach to we're going to sell a gigahertz processor or a 2 gigahertz processor, 3 gigahertz processor, the energetics or the thermal dissipation of that are prohibitive. So there's a limit to how high frequency you can go. So they fixed the frequency roughly at a gigahertz for 5 or 6 years. Recently, the frequencies on the GPUs are beginning to climb up as they've gone to a smaller die process. This is a slightly old GPU. Now, in the analogy of the chip being the university, these are the graduate students. Many, many graduate students not much in the way of faculty administration getting in their way. Admittedly, a lot of the time, those graduate students are twiddling their thumbs. But there's a lot of them. So as long as there's a lot of them and only a good proportion of them are doing something, then you can actually get good performance. And just to reiterate that point, these are contemporary GPU and CPU. GPU left, CPU right. This is all worker. This is worker. So you can, if you're willing to write the code to direct the graduate students on the GPU, you were able at that point to get much better performance on the GPU than the CPU. It's about 2008. How did they get so many graduate students onto the chip? How did they get so many ALUs onto the chip? Well, they slimmed down the core. So they got rid of out-of-order logic prediction. So out-of-order prediction, or out-of-order control logic. So the scheduler on the GPU core doesn't, or didn't originally, cherry pick the next operation to execute. You basically had a static schedule, and it would run through the static schedule of operations. Instead of saying, OK, I can do this operation, even though it's not a next in the queue, it's a tenth in the queue, but the data is ready for that tenth operation, which was what you do on the CPU. On the GPU, you just stall the thread until the next operation was ready to run. Get rid of the branch prediction. Again, it's OK if a GPU thread stalls. It's only responsible for a few pixels. It doesn't matter if they arrive a bit late. Get rid of the cache. That was a ballsy move. They got rid of a lot of the cache infrastructure from the CPU. It takes up space, right? And then they introduced programmer-controlled caches, texture caches, and other types of caches that meant that as the programmer, if you knew exactly how to schedule your data, then you could still get good throughput. The trouble is, if you didn't do a good job of scheduling your data movement, then you'd actually get atrocious speed up. You'd get slow down. GPU would run slower than the CPU. And they got rid of the on-chip cache largely, large cache banks. So you slim these things down. You freed up all that silicon. If you think about that die shot, you think about the annotated die shot, we've got rid of vast amounts of management. We've got rid of the middle management that sits between data and processor, or between data and ALU. So with all that extra space, help, just print more cores. Right? Makes sense? You got rid of the control structure. You've got these dumb cores. We can put a lot of them onto the silicon. Now, the next step, which is to realize that each of these cores, or each of these ALUs, they're all pretty much doing the same thing. You've got this sort of translational invariance in your picture. The task operation you're doing in one pixel is more or less exactly the same as the task operation at the pixel over here, right? It's the same operations. It's basically projective geometry and interpolation. So instead of having a single ALU, we move to multiple ALUs per core. But instead of having multiple instruction fetch units, we're just going to have one instruction fetch unit, which is going to feed the same stream of instructions to all these worker ALUs, which is what Tim Madsen introduced as SIMT yesterday, or SIMD is sort of a more generic term. So there's going to be one set of instructions, and they're going to be fed concurrently to a number of ALUs. All the ALUs are going to do exactly the same operation in exactly the same sequence concurrently. Now, that would be somewhat limiting as a program model because these ALUs would not be able to collaborate in any meaningful sense, not using local fast memory. So the next step is to add shared memory so that those ALUs can actually work on shared data, right? So it starts to look a little bit like the shared shared memory compute model. Now, you take that core, and it's still smaller than the regular CPU core, and you replicate it. So you get a multi-core device. We have, in this just baby example, we have 128 parallel instruction streams. So how many? I've got 16 cores. Each core has its own single instruction stream, and each instruction stream is acted on by 8 ALUs. So this is a sort of synthetic abstract model of what a GPU is. Okay? It's not too far away from what the actual model is. Here's an example of an NVIDIA Maxwell class GPU. So that is not the current latest generation, but previous generation. It's a little tricky to see, but I think there are 16 of these cores. This is a single Maxwell core. There's some marketing terminology here. NVIDIA would like you to believe that one of the ALUs, this guy here, and in fact it's actually labeled as a core, it is not a core. A core, from my perspective, is an instruction unit that is capable of issuing its own set of instructions. The NVIDIA core is just able to consume instructions. Okay, so there's a big difference there. What NVIDIA calls a core, I'll just call an ALU or a SIMD unit. Okay, so when NVIDIA advertises that their GPU has 3,880 cores, what they're telling you is they have 3,880 floating point units or arithmetic logic units. In fact, what they have is, in this case, 16 cores. Each core is equipped with 4 32-wide vector units. Okay? So each vector unit is capable of concurrently doing 32 operations. Now, those operations can be multiply adds, fused multiply adds. So technically, they can issue 64 floating point operations per cycle. Does that make sense? Any questions about this? So this is a concrete example of an NVIDIA GPU block diagram. Here's the board. Here's the chip. Here's the layout of the chip. It's divided into 16 cores in this case. And each core in this case has 128 floating point units organized into 32 SIMD wide vector units. Okay, does that make sense? Now if you look closely, and we'll come back to this in a minute, I'm afraid it's really hard to read, but each of the SIMD units has its own register file. It has its own shared memory. Actually, this is shared amongst, there, it's down there. Each of these, so 4 SIMD units have a pool of shared memory. So a thread executing on any of these floating point units will be able to access the shared memory associated with that core. So you can do collaborative work amongst the threads concurrently active here. So now let's get to the similarities and differences of the CPU and the GPU. There's one striking difference between an Intel CPU core and an NVIDIA streaming multiprocessor core. You achieve some level of instruction level parallelism in the Intel core, and you also have vector floating point units, and these are getting wider and wider. But the tricky thing with the Intel core is the Intel core can execute vector operations or scalar operations. So if you write a piece of code, and the compiler doesn't identify that some of the operations in a loop can be done in a vector way, i.e., you could chunk the loop up into chunks of 8 and then do those 8 operations concurrently. If the compiler doesn't identify it, you will not exercise the vector floating point units. You will be relegated to using the scalar floating point units or the scalar integer units. Okay? Which is good and bad. It means there's always a sort of default case that your code will always achieve some level of performance because there are multiple integer units, multiple scalar floating point units. So there's always that fallback. And most codes, if they've not been heavily optimized, will fall into that category of using the scalar execution units on the CPU core. Once you get into optimizing a CPU code through OpenMP or through using intrinsic vector operations, then you start to see the vector units get used. But it can be quite tricky because you may have to persuade the compiler that it's legal to use the vector operations. There are restrictions on when you can and can't use the vector operations, whether the data for the vector operator is appropriately page aligned, if everything is in the right place. It's a matter of juggling a lot of things to actually make sure that the CPU code can be properly vectorized. Once you do that, you can get reasonable performance, but it can take a lot of effort. On the other hand, the GPU at its core is only a vector machine. It doesn't have scalar operators, scalar execution units. It just has vector execution units. So unlike the CPU has a mixture of scalar and vector operators, or execution units. The GPU only has vector execution units, which means that it can be a lot easier to get good performance out of the GPU, as long as you're kind of lucky, because you don't necessarily have to fight to persuade the compiler, to fight to persuade the device to actually perform vector operations. They are the default operation, the only type of operation. Does that make sense? Yeah? So this is one of the primary differences and why it can be easier to get good performance on the GPU than the CPU. Because it's just, well, if you can trace this back, this mixture of scalar and vector units really is an issue of history. The x86 architecture is laden with baggage from the earlier days when you only had the scalar processor. So they've carried that forward. And it becomes sort of the default behavior for the x86 architecture that if you don't pay attention to the way you code, you'll just get scalar performance. You won't exercise the SIMD units, sort of AVX units. Now, the GPU, because at its core is a vector device, that raises some issues. And the primary issue is what happens if you want some threads in a group? So if you've got 32-wide vector unit, and you want some of them to be doing one thing and other threads in that SIMD group to be doing other things, well, that's when we start to lose the parallelism. So here's a piece of code. I'm going to have some non-branching code that does setup and then decides each thread will have its own flag variable. Some threads will have flag which is one, some threads will have a flag which is zero, and then we'll have some branching code. And what happens is that when you look at code that gets executed by the GPU, which has conditional statements in it, it's really quite dumb. The GPU will actually traverse every branch in your code. When a thread is active and supposed to be in a branch, it'll do the operations. When a thread is not active and it's not supposed to be in a branch, it'll just execute a non-operation. It'll basically spin its wheel. So if only one of these eight ALUs was supposed to be doing something, you're getting 1/8 of the actual performance that you could get. So it's kind of topsy-turvy, right? So on the CPU, you have to persuade the execution units to do vector operations. On the GPU, you have to persuade the execution units to do scalar operations, right? So there's a really quite a different flavor to the way you program these things. Now, the other thing that happens is that once a thread, which is working on register variables, needs to extract data from the device's memory. Remember, the device has its own pool of memory. The memory chip's off the main chip. There's a very long latency, order of 1,000 cycles. So a thread that's working on one of these cores wants some data from that off device memory. Takes 1,000 cycles to deliver that data, which would be catastrophic, because if every time your threads stall, it takes 1,000 cycles to recover, then that would be bad news, right? But think about what I said before. We over-provisioned a number of threads, so there's going to be many, many threads available to step in when that thread stalls. So instead of stalling this ALU and just not doing anything for 1,000 cycles, there's fast context switching. So you'll bring in threads which were idle, have data they can use, and can continue until they request data from off-chip. They'll stall. You'll switch to other threads. Okay. So the first ingredient is vectorization at the core of the architecture. Second ingredient for GPU is fast context switching between threads, thread groups, really. If you think about it, we need to swap 32 threads out and bring 32 new threads in. Because you think about that SIMD architecture, we need to have 32 threads concurrently active. Because what matters is not the time it takes the blue threads to do their thing, but the overall time for the calculation. Because remember, back to the pixel issue, as long as all the threads are done in our cutoff time, then we're good to go, right? So it doesn't matter if they stall, as long as we've got the core being active all the time. Now, to support this, there's a third difference between the GPU and the CPU core. The Skylake core that I have the diagram for had 180 integer registers and 168 floating point registers. The Maxwell core has about 16,000 registers. So that lets us load up the register values associated with these threads that are running on the Maxwell core, and you can have a lot of threads co-resident. Okay? You can have more threads, more than 128 threads resident at one time, as long as each thread is taking less than 16,000 divided by 128. So that tells you that the register count, or the total registers used by each thread, shouldn't be too large. Because you want to have as many co-resident threads as possible on the core. The other thing is, when you load up the thread's data, it's going to stay there until that thread stops. So you really don't want to have a thread that takes 16K of data. There would be one thread possibly that could possibly execute on these 128 floating point units. So you really want to have threads which have a small number of registers and a small number of local variables that are required to complete their task. So let me reiterate. We have multiple cores. Each core has one or more. In that last example, we had four SIMD vector units. And each SIMD vector unit executes one instruction stream. So those 32 floating point units are doing exactly the same set of operations. Different data, same set of operations, with the exception of threads that are not active in the line of code that's being executed because they are not part of that branch structure. Right? That was the so-called SIMT designation. And each core has a pool of shared memory which is accessible by all threads in that are executing on that device, on that core. All the cores, each core shares a register file which is shared privately among the arithmetic logic units. And each core can hardware switch between multiple contexts to hide memory latency. And branch encode involves partial serialization. And there's a nice summary here. You can click on that. OK, so that's the abstract architecture model. What the actual architecture model is, I can't tell you. But that's the mental model I've developed to program these devices. Behind the scenes, I can't tell you exactly how this set of instructions gets mapped onto hardware. This proprietary NVIDIA information, I can't tell you, right? There's some magical translation between our high-level programming realization, or the high-level abstraction we keep in mind, and the actual dirty stuff that happens on the GPU, okay? So there's a little bit of a mismatch between what I've just shown you and, in reality, what happens on the device. But in the last 8 years, that mental model has been sufficient to get reasonable performance on the GPUs. Okay. So how do we program these things? Okay, that's the more interesting question. So here's the GPU. We have a very large, this is a Fermi class GPU. This has up to 16 cores. Each one of them has a 32-wide SIMD unit, okay? Each Fermi core, total, the communication bandwidth between the processor and the memory was, in this case, it was about 200 gigabytes per second. But collectively, between these 512 floating point units, we could execute 1.4 teraflops. So if you do some handy-dandy division, you can figure out that in order to get the peak performance out of this device, you would have to do 28 floating point operations per float move between the device and memory. So 28 floats for every floating point flops for every load, 28 flops per store, which means that to get maximum performance out of this device, you'd have to have an algebraically dense, algebraically complicated set of operations you wanted to do. In general, we don't get close to the peak performance of this hardware, because if you think about a finite difference code, or a finite volume, or a spectral element, or a spectral difference, or discontinuous Galerkin, or whatever your favorite discretization is, if that's what you do, those are optimized to minimize the number of floating point operations that we do per load store, right? So it's not quite, there's sort of a mismatch between the hardware here and what you have to do to get peak performance. So what we try and do is maximize the rate at which we stream data from the device memory to the device. So we'll underperform on flops, but we'll hopefully get good performance in terms of data streaming. Okay, so that's something to think about. We go to one generation further on. This was the Kepler class GPU. This was a real monster. So the Fermi class was optimized for compute. You just had to find 32-way parallelism. There was a good balance between the number of registers, the amount of shared memory, that all those 32 floating point units were sharing. So this, I think the architecture for this was determined in part by a push from NVIDIA Research, who wanted a compute-capable GPU. Next generation, the GPU side, the graphics side of NVIDIA, pushed back and says, actually, we need a different architecture. We need a lot of floating point units in order to satisfy the graphics market. So they flipped from simple cores up to now having 192 floating point units, and they were sharing largely the same amount of register space and the same amount of shared memory space. So this was not a great architecture for general compute on GPUs. But look, they could claim headline performance on the order of 4 teraflops. Very good. But the amount of memory bandwidth that they got didn't even double. So we had to generate even more floating point operations per load store, more like 50 floating point operations. And we're well beyond what most numerical codes can do or actually require. So then we've gone up from 32 to 192, and we went back to 128 floating point units per core. And we still, it's bandwidth limited. And this is the latest device. This one's quite interesting. The Pascal class GPU, the professional level version, has up to 60 cores. I think, I'm not sure, but I have a feeling that there's some response to Intel in this choice of how many cores they put on this thing. And then each core only has 64 floating point units, but it also has more double precision units than it does than all the previous class of NVIDIA GPUs. So the previous generations were mostly single precision heavy in terms of floating point units. Now they've improved the ratio. But this is going to be a very expensive part to buy. The consumer versions will not either not have these double precision units, the green ones are single, orange ones are double, either not have them activated or not have them, probably just not have them activated. Okay? So this is important from the numerical perspective that if you're going to be doing turbulence modeling or something like that, which is highly sensitive to the precision available or the hardware precision available, then this is going to be a much more interesting part than the previous GPUs, where the double precision performance is going to be much better. And the other thing that's interesting is because we've only got, in this case, 64 floating point units per core, but the provisioning of each core has stayed more or less the same as before, we now got a much better ratio of registers per floating point unit and shared memory per floating point unit. So this thing could be an absolute beast for compute. So hopefully I'll get hold of one of these soon and be able to try them. The consumer variants aren't going to be quite as interesting. If you look at the ratio of the single precision floating point performance, the double precision floating point performance, it takes a real hit. The professional one will generate 10 teraflops single, 5 teraflops double. The consumer one, 10 teraflops single, 1/3 of a teraflop double. And I think this is going to be reflected in the price. The consumer version will be about $1,000. The professional one is going to be a lot of money, which is unfortunate, but there you go. So let's look at some generations of these cores. When we started, this is what the core looked like. It was 2 SIMD units 8 wide. We went to 3 SIMD units 8 wide, to 132 wide, to a lot of floating point units. And then they backed off back down to the smaller cores. So they went up the core count. They went to the cores that had a lot of floating point units, and they're now back down to something. And I think this is going to be a lot more programmable than some of the previous generations, in particular Kepler. Okay. This is mostly marketing. And the other thing is they're experimenting with different form factors. But again, that's not going to be in the consumer level devices. So if we think about the memory hierarchy, and frankly, anybody working in numerical PDEs, we are 100% memory bound at all time. We never generate enough flops to fully exercise all those floating point units. It's for us. What we're trying to do is maximize the bandwidth usage, the maximize the amount of data flowing between the GPU memory and the GPU. On device, memory traffic in the form of shared memory and register data transfers in excess of terabytes. Between the device and the device memory, this is a little old. It used to be up to 330 gigabytes. It's now up to a terabyte. Per second. And then between the device and the host, there's a real bottleneck. The current PCI Express 3 bottleneck is about 16 gigabytes per second. The next generation of transport mechanisms that aren't going to be in the consumer devices will be much higher than that, on the order of 80 to 100 gigabytes per second, I believe. And then you have the CPU bandwidth, which is also another bottleneck. So if we look at this funnel shape in the memory hierarchy, what we realize is that we're going to have to offload the problem onto the GPU, do as much work on the GPU, minimizing communication between the GPU and its own memory. And then once we've done a whole buttload of work, then we'll pull data off this device and consume it on the CPU. If we're continually shifting large amounts of data between the device and the host, we will get the bandwidth, effective bandwidth of the bottleneck in the whole memory hierarchy. We'll get this bandwidth. If we keep the problem on the GPU and do the work on there as much as possible, then we can achieve the higher bandwidth. Okay? And you see there's orders of magnitude difference between those bandwidths. So how do we program these damn things? CUDA, the CUDA language, is laced with terminology that's derived from weaving. For instance, warp, thread, texture. Can anybody see any problems with this analogy? Their notion of a thread being one of these threads. Is weaving a serial process or a parallel process? One vote for, hands up if you think it's parallel, hands up if you think it's serial. Which is that, parallel? Serial, we got a serial. Anybody else? Parallel? No, don't care? That's most of you, right? Weaving, this is my wife's mini loom, is inherently a serial process. And in this case, the threads don't actually do anything. They are static. The action is of the shuttle running backwards and forwards, moving the thread across the thread, moving a shuttle which carries a thread across the main threads. It's an inherently serial process. So whichever dumbass decided to use weaving terminology in as terminology for a parallel threading process was just stupid. And it's an inherently serial process. If this was going to be a good analogy, these threads would be actively doing something concurrently, i.e. at the same time. Okay. But terminology aside, this was NVIDIA's great contribution, was the development of the CUDA programming model. Long after CUDA, I mean, NVIDIA has been absorbed in some other entity, this program model should survive. It came about 2007. It's basically it's based on some PhD work at Stanford. The Stanford group had a program model called Brook. Brook's related to stream, more bad terminology. And some of the better PhD students from Stanford went to NVIDIA, and they productized Brook, more or less. Some of the students went to AMD, or in fact ATI, and they tried to productize it. They called it Brook AMD, and it was concurrent with CUDA, but for some reason, NVIDIA prevailed. So the programming model for CUDA is very much a host device model. This will be your GPU. We're going to allocate arrays on the GPU's memory using CUDA malloc. Whatever NVIDIA tries to persuade you that there's a universal address space, ignore that. If you follow that to its conclusion, then you would draw no distinction between data that's sitting on the GPU, data that's sitting on the CPU, and you will incur the memory bottleneck between the transfer bottleneck between the CPU and the GPU. Always think about these as separate devices with their own separate memory space. They have virtualized the memory space, so you can use a pointer, which can be generically either a CPU pointer or a GPU pointer. Just ignore that facility. Until the bandwidth between device and host has improved, you'll write slow code if you use their virtualized, their unified virtual address space. So we'll use CUDA malloc, which is analogous to the C malloc standard library command, to allocate space on the CUDA device. It'll sit inside one of these memory units, or several of these memory units. We will copy data from the device, from the host to the device using CUDA memcopy, which is an analog of the C standard memcopy call function. We will queue up a task on the device. Remember, this is a quasi-autonomous compute device. It has its own queue of tasks to perform. We'll ask it to perform a task. Once it's done, we will copy the data back from the device to the host. That's it. That can be our entire interaction with this GPU. We'll just need to use a CUDA malloc, CUDA memcopy. We'll use a special syntax for queuing a task on here, and then we'll CUDA memcopy the data back. So two API calls. That's it. Plus weird syntax for starting some task on the device. Now, if you think about the architecture, we're going to have to set up a bunch of threads that are going to run on this device. So we'll have to decide how to take our compute task and divide it into independent work blocks. And that's important. We have to think about what are independent subtasks of our global task. We're going to add two vectors together, two arrays. We're going to add their entries together one by one without a reduction, just vector operation, vector add operation. Then we're going to have to figure out how to partition that operation and then initialize or set up enough threads that we've got enough threads that can take chunks of that operation and do them independently. That's very important. Each core will process the work block with work group of threads. So if we say want to divide a problem up into groups of 128 threads, then those 128 threads are all going to have to be co-resident on that core. And then the 128 threads will be concurrently processed in batches of 32. And then some details. The main assumption is it's going to be the same set of instruction for independent work groups. In fact, it's more detailed than that. It's going to be the same set of instructions for each thread. Okay. So here's the host code. This is the code that's going to run on your PC or on the cluster. So we're going to include the CUDA.h, going to create some arrays of length n. I'm going to use CUDA malloc to initialize, to allocate that much space on the device. I'm going to decide how many threads. In this case, I've decided for some reason to use 17 threads per block and divide the problem up into groups of 17. And then I've decided that I need enough blocks so that I've got, if I take n and divide by 17 and round up, I've got enough blocks that I'll have one thread per entry in the addition or whatever I'm going to do to this array. I think we're just going to do something to each entry of the array. Then I've got some weird, wacky, non-standard C syntax. Has anybody ever seen this syntax before in C? No, because it's not standard C. It's a CUDA extension of the C language, where a function call is really a kernel start request. We're going to allocate this many blocks of threads, this many threads per block, and these are going to be arguments passed to each thread. Each thread will know something about the size of the problem and some pointer to storage associated with this problem. Then we'll allocate some host storage, copy the result back from the device to the host. Here's the tells us which way the memcopy is going to happen. And then once the data's on the host, we can print out the result. 90% of CUDA programs look like this. Allocate some space, do stuff with that space, copy the result back. So just to reiterate, we allocate space with CUDA malloc. We design the array of threads. In this case, I've decided 512 threads per block, and then enough blocks to cover. In this case, I'm going to have each thread do one, or set the value of one entry in the array. Queue the task on the GPU with that specification of the thread array, and then copy the result back. Does that make sense? That's pretty much the core of what you need to do to coordinate the problem from the host. The next part of this is we've got to actually design the kernel and decide what each thread is going to do based on its thread rank. But let me back up a little bit. And let's assume this is what we want the serial, if we were going to write this code in serial, this is the serial tasks that we would do. Okay? In this case, I'm just going to store the entry 0 through n minus 1 in the array. Right? So that's what I want my kernel to do. In fact, whenever you write a CUDA kernel, start with the serial version first. Make sure the serial version does what you want to do, because if you have a mistake in the serial version, you'll never get the parallel version to work properly. So always start with a conceptual realization of what the task is you want to do. Okay? So let's say we decided we've got a vector, in this case of length n is 20, and I'm going to divide it up into chunks of 4. So instead of doing a serial loop from 0 to 19, I'm going to chunk that single for loop into a double for loop, nested for loop. I'm going to assume that the number of blocks is provided by some intrinsic variable griddim. Number of threads, that's the number of threads I'm going to associate with the task, the subtask in each block, is provided by blockdim. So I'm gradually getting closer to introducing NVIDIA's crappy intrinsic variable definitions. Behind the scenes, each thread is provided with some information about how many blocks there are on the grid and how many threads are in each block. Once I've got this double loop, I'll need to reconstruct a linear index into the array. I'm just partitioning this block into loop over blocks, loop over entries in the block. So to go from a double index, which is block and thread, to the linear index array n, I have to reconstruct it. This is directly analogous to using MPI rank to decide on what each rank is going to do. In the case of CUDA, we have a multi-dimensional thread rank. Each thread will know that its thread index local to the block and its block index relevant to the grid of blocks. Okay? Given those two pieces of information, you can then decide on a universal global index for that thread. And here I've decided that each thread is just going to update one index. Or in another way of looking at it is each iteration of this nested for loop is going to do one thing. Notice here, I've had to guard to make sure that my reconstructed index is in the admissible range for the vector. First of all, notice that this has nothing to do with the SIMD structure. Eventually, this blocked in, it doesn't need to be a multiple of 32. It will get chunked and handled in groups of 32, but it can be not a multiple of 32 because CUDA can always pad the threads. But if we take an array here, and we've got 37 entries, then there's no way I can split that into subchunks and not have a remainder. So the last block, we have to guard against it, the reconstructed index being out of range, if the size of the problem doesn't neatly divide the number of things, doesn't neatly divide into subblocks. OK, so we go from this notation to proper CUDA notation for the block index, the grid dimension, which is number of blocks, the thread index, and the size of each block of threads. Notice we've now got these are structs. So they have X, Y, and Z components, because each thread doesn't just have one rank. It has 6 ranks. You can think of the block grid as being a 3-dimensional lattice of blocks. And the thread rank of each block is a three-dimensional index in that there's a three-dimensional sub-block of threads. So it's like a Rubik's cube, where each of the cubes of the Rubik's cube is divided, it's further divided into a Rubik's cube, right? So that's the thread hierarchy that we're dealing with here. In this case, I've only chosen to use one of the indices of the 3x3 index space. Notice, I haven't defined what these quantities are. They are going to be externally provided thread indices. Each thread will know its thread IDX, its thread index, and its block IDX, its block index. Okay, that'll be provided. That's why it doesn't appear there. But if you notice, every thread is executing the same instruction, right? There's no dependence on, first of all, there's no loop carry dependence. Each operation is independent of every operation in this thing, in this whole loop structure. And the second thing to note is that when we look at the body of the loop, when we map this to a thread, every thread will execute this instruction, which is create a global index and then check if it's a valid index and then do a write if it's valid. Yes?
Just given that the point you mentioned earlier, that we hide latency by having multiple threads, mm-hmm. usually in this part of the code, you are not actually hiding latency because all the threads are just going and getting some data from the memory. So what kind of useful computer are they doing at this part of the code?
Right, so some threads will be computing that.
I assume it will be only a few clock cycles.
Exactly.
But there will be hundreds of threads competing and available. So some will be doing this. When they stall out for this read, others will pop in, do this calculation, and they will be making this request for data. And it'll be compute stall, compute stall, compute stall, and we'll have hundreds of threads ready to step in to as soon as the data, this is a bit tricky because they're just issuing store requests. So they're basically store and die. So it doesn't matter if they stalled at this point.
But you feel like you're loading and then you're synchronizing and then you do something else. So
well, there's no synchronization here.
I mean,
usually,
you're loading and then, yeah.
Yeah, so that's a bit further down the path, right? But yes, that's a very good point. This thread is almost doing nothing. But this is typically what we'll do to achieve maximal throughput. The stalls, in this case, it doesn't matter if it stalls, because it doesn't, if a thread stalls, it doesn't impact, in this case, any further operations it's going to do. But don't worry about that yet. Okay. So how does this look when we translate it to actual CUDA code? I'll come back to this specification in a minute. We'll take that inner part of this partitioned loop, and this is what is exposed in the kernel code. This is a proper CUDA kernel. Instead of explicitly writing out what the loop structure that's implicit here is, we will just encode in the kernel the piece of code that is executed in the innermost part of that parallel loop structure. Because this is the marching orders, these are the marching orders for each thread. Each thread will be able to query its own index, its own block size, or the global block size, and its block index. So it's analogous to the thread query or MPI process querying its MPI rank. Okay, based on its rank, it decides what to do. Some threads will store a value, some threads will not. Okay, that's it. That's encapsulated 70 to 80% of what a CUDA kernel does. It's the innermost part of a parallel loop structure, a nested parallel loop structure. Does that make sense? And to execute it, we'll say, run this kernel at some point in the future. with this many blocks and with blocks of this size, with these arguments. You see the arguments get pushed into the kernel. All of the threads will receive a copy of n and a copy of the pointer da. They all access shared memory on the device, not the shared memory on the core, not on the GPU itself, but the shared memory in that those banks of memory arranged around the outside of the GPU. Okay? So they all have access to a global shared memory space. There's another decoration. I put this in to remind myself because I don't see this stuff now. It's sort of background noise. But to you, it's important to notice that this annotation means that this is going to be treated by the NVIDIA compiler as a kernel, and it will generate kernel code. The binary it generates will be copied across the PCI Express bus onto the GPU and inserted into the queue of tasks that needs to be performed by the GPU. That process actually induces a launch cost. The launch cost can be measured in microseconds. So if the task to be performed by the GPU is much less than a microsecond, then it will still cost you some number of microseconds to execute that task. So we already see that the GPU is going to favor large tasks, where the task is on the order of milliseconds rather than microseconds. So don't think you can just take call a kernel, give it a scalar float, and ask for a scalar float back, because that should take a nanosecond, but it will take a microsecond to perform that task because of the induced launch overhead. Each thread will use this thread rank information to reconstruct some index. Now, I didn't need to give it this simple linear index into the array space. I could have said, work backwards from the end of the vector to the start of the vector. So I could have said capital N minus 1 minus this quantity. And I could have had the threads populating that array from the end to the beginning. This is just a convenient map from the thread rank space into the vector space. I could have also said each thread could update more than one value in the array. I could have put a while loop, or I could have just unrolled it and said multiple instructions here. Just the simplest way to show you that you can partition the problem and have each thread do a small amount of work. The registers required, well, just a handful of registers to do this arithmetic, probably a couple of registers to do this, and a register for this variable and a register for this variable. So it's on the order of 5 to 8 registers just to do this task. And this is the specific operation that each thread is going to choose to do. So although I dwelled at length on the architecture as being 32 wide SIMD, it doesn't mean that the number of threads per thread block needs to be a multiple of 32, because they can always be padded. So if you choose 17, CUDA will automatically insert non-operations for the 17 minus 32, 32 minus 17. So if 17 threads would be doing something, 15 would be doing nothing. Okay?